Hello everyone, I am Dr. Yogesh Pavade. I am Assistant Professor in Department of Biochemistry in SETGS Medical College and KM Hospital. Today we are going to see a very important practical based on which there are many quantitative estimations in MBBS biochemistry syllabus. So that is colorimetry, spectrophotometry and automation in clinical biochemistry. We'll see what are the specific learning objectives, which are the competencies covered under this topic. So as per CBAB, 11.6, 11.16, 11.18, these are the competencies which are covered, which will be covered in this session. My specific learning objectives for at the end of the session are: phase 1 MBBS student shall be able to state Bayer's law and Lambert's law, describe the principle, application and working of colorimeter with its labeled block diagram, describe the relationship between absorbance and transmittance, describe the principle and applications of spectrophotometry with its labeled block diagram, describe the differences between colorimetry and spectrophotometry, explain the automation in laboratory, describe the principle and applications of autoanalyzer. So coming to principles of colorimetry. Colorimetry and calorimetry, these are different techniques. So we have been correcting papers and looking at the answers written for colorimetry, like they write calorimetry. So colorimetry and calorimetry are different. As the name indicates, it relates to color if it is colorimetry, and calor means heat. So it is measurement of the energy, heat energy. So remember, write colorimetry, our spelling should be proper. What is colorimetry? As the name indicates, it's measurement of color. So concentration of the compounds here is determined by measuring the intensity of the color. Intensity of the color is proportional to the concentration of the compound being measured. So for this, the compound which is to be measured has to have some color, and intensity of which will be measured. So however, many compounds of clinical importance in our body are not colored, like for example sugar, proteins, urea, creatinine, these are not colored. So there has to be some chemical reaction or some colored complexes needs to be formed so that the intensity of the complex will be measured. So you'll see the methods are evolved like that, so as to develop a particular color, and within a photometric range the optical density needs to be measured. So the methods are developed accordingly. The relationship between the concentration and color intensity is given by Bayer's and Lambert's law. So we'll see what are those laws. Bayer's law and Lambert's law. What Bayer's law states, more or less the wording is same. When monochromatic light passes through a light absorbing medium, monochromatic light, a single wavelength, passes through a light absorbing medium, the intensity of the transmitted light decreases exponentially. It is not linear, it is exponentially decreasing as the concentration of the light absorbing material increases. Remember guys, this law is not stating in terms of absorbance, it is stating in terms of transmittance. So the intensity of the transmitted light decreases exponentially as the concentration of the light absorbing material increases. What does Lambert state? When monochromatic light, again single wavelength, monochromatic light passes through a light absorbing medium, the intensity of the transmitted light decreases exponentially as the length of the light path through which the light absorbing material increases. So the path length, if it is more will be the amount or the quantity of light absorbing substance. So the light passes through that particular amount of substance. If the path length is more, the transmitted light will be decreasing. So if this is the path length and that much is the path length, so the transmitted light from this particular path length will be less, so it decreases exponentially. Now to combine these two laws, what we do in a colorimeter is, we keep the path length or the cuvette inner diameter same. So the path length is kept constant. Thus, if the path length of the light path is kept constant, the intensity of the light, transmitted light, decreases exponentially as the concentration of light absorbing material increases. So when the Lambert law is constant, Bayer law will be varying. So we have to verify the Bayer's law in the next practical exercise after the demonstration. What is the relationship between absorbance and transmittance? First of all, what is absorbance? Absorbance, it is called as optical density. And transmittance is the amount of light transmitted, is transmittance. So transmittance is defined as the ratio of intensity of light emerging to the intensity of light incident. So the intensity of light incident and intensity of light emerging out of a color absorbing substance. So that is the transmittance. So it's a fraction of intensity of light which is coming out. Okay. This is the relation, T equal to intensity of light emerging divided by intensity of light incident. So T equal to I upon IO. Taking percentages, percent transmittance equal to 100 into I upon IO. We are shifting 100 towards left hand side. So percent transmittance divided by 100 equal to I and IO. What is absorbance? That is OD. It decreases exponentially, so it is minus log of transmittance. So OD equal to minus log of I upon IO, because T equal to I upon IO, that we have already seen. T equal to I upon IO. So OD equal to minus log of percent transmittance divided by 100, because I upon IO equal to percent transmittance divided by 100. So OD comes out to be log of 100 minus log of percent transmittance. Log of 100 is 2 minus log of percent transmittance is optical density. So optical density maximum is 2 theoretically. What are the factors affecting transmittance? What are the factors which affect particular intensity of light to get maximally absorbed by the light absorbing substance? Because there might be two different solutions of the same color. Two different solutions. One may be a, say for example, some color, blue light. Like if it is like a color complex developed after uric acid estimation, for the uric acid estimation, and the color complex developed in fall-in-woe method of glucose estimation, both are blue, but the nature of light absorbing substance is different, so the transmittance will be different. And likewise, we have to select the wavelength of light also for that particular substance. Color intensity of the particular substance varies with the nature, so wavelength has to be chosen like for that. These are the factors. What are the factors? Nature of light absorbing substance, we have already said. Difference in the substances, though the color is same, though the concentration is same of the two different substances, but the transmittance or the absorbance will be different for those cases. Now, choosing a wavelength of light is such that it will be maximally absorbed by the light absorbing substance. Maximally absorbed means least will be the transmittance, so that our photocell will not get burnt. Because it is sensitive, minimum the transmittance, higher will be the sensitivity of the photocell. We have to choose it like that. Again, wavelength of light depends on the nature of light absorbing substance as well. Say for example, in case of Benedict uric acid test, after quantitative estimation, we choose yellow color. But in case of fall-in-woe method, we choose blue color filter for blue color, because usually, as a general rule, to choose a wavelength, we see the complementary color. Suppose if the solution is green in color, we choose red filter. Solution is red in color, we choose green filter. Solution is blue, we choose yellow filter or red filter, depending on the substance. So the colors has to be complementary. But for certain, different substances, like in case fall-in-woe method, as the method is not specific, values are very high, we choose blue color filter for blue colored substance developed. Okay. Then third factor is amount of light absorbing substance in the light path that we have already seen in Lambert's law. Because if the path length is more, more will be the amount of light absorbing substance in the light path. So it depends on the concentration of light absorbing substance and depth of the solution through which the light passes. Okay. So these three factors are there. Absorbance, a characteristic of substance, because the relation which is expressed here is OD equal to KCl. K is the constant characteristic of a substance. As we have already said, it depends on the nature of the light absorbing substance. So K will be the constant for that particular substance. C is the concentration and L is the length or depth of the solution, which will be varying if different solutions are used. Okay. So deriving a relationship between absorbance and transmittance, let us consider two solutions of the same substance but of different concentration. So here C will be different. Okay. One is acting as standard, other one is going to be estimated, that is of unknown concentration. Okay. And for standard, OD of standard equal to KS, CS and LS. KS into CS into LS. And for unknown, OD of unknown equal to KU into CU into LU. But we are taking the same substance, so KS, the constant will be same, KS equal to KU. And we are going to use the same caveat for colorimeter, so the path length will be same, so LS equal to LU. Hence, OD of unknown, the ratio of OD of unknown to OD of standard equals to concentration of unknown to concentration of standard. So if we know concentration of standard, which we already know, which we usually know, we can easily find out concentration of unknown by knowing the optical density of unknown and optical density of standard. The concentration of unknown equal to OD of unknown divided by OD of standard into concentration of standard. Hence, the concentration of unknown substance in 100 ml of serum, because we usually express our values or the analytes in units of percent or per 100 ml. So we usually take per 100 ml, or if we are going to use SI unit, then per liter of the serum. So concentration of unknown equals to OD of unknown divided by OD of standard into concentration of standard. Here it is in units of milligram, so it is amount of standard actually into 100 divided by volume of sample in ml. But this concentration of standard needs to be split into concentration and volume. Okay, because we can't find out the we can't take amount into concentration. We are deriving this formula. Concentration of unknown equal to OD of unknown divided by OD of standard into concentration of standard in units of milligram per ml. Then volume of standard in units of ml into 100, because we are going to take 100 ml of serum or 1 deciliter, divided by volume of sample in units of ml. This is the formula which will be used in most of the quantitative estimations except estimation of enzyme activities. Okay, there we derive different formula, but this formula is same for almost all the analytes. What is the technique? Colorimetry technique involves three steps. Preparation of the colored solution is very important, because if it does not have color, it can't measure the optical density. So preparation of a colored solution, if it is colored, then okay. If it is not colored, we have to make it colored by some chemical reaction with coloring agent. Okay, or certain chemicals are there which will give you some colored complex. Okay. And then similar treatment to the standard solution of the same substance. So if we are interested in estimating creatinine in unknown solution, we have to have one standard solution of creatinine, because the concentration of which will be known to us. We can find out concentration of unknown solution, concentration of creatinine in unknown solution. by color comparison, that is the third step. Color comparison by measuring transmittance or optical density of standard as well as unknown. This is how the colorimeter looks like. In sports, you may get a question on identification of the instrument. So, models may be different of colorimeter. You will see one or two knobs to change the filter. You may see an analog galvanometer or maybe a digital one, or a place where the cuvette will be placed. Okay, so essentially these 3-4 key points will be there for identification of the colorimeter. The colorimeter in our lab may not resemble this one, but actually it will have these 3 or 4 key points which will make you identify the colorimeter. Okay, and coming to the block diagram of colorimeter, you can see a tungsten lamp, one slit, condensing lens so that the rays are going to be made parallel, and this one is the filter. We'll see one by one later. This one is the filter, this one is the cuvette. You can see this cuvette. This is the cuvette in which we are going to fill the colored solution, and this is photocell, means transmitted light from cuvette will be measured by this photocell, and it will be displayed in the form of analog or digital galvanometer. So let us see one by one what is tungsten lamp and is the light source. Okay, it will be a colored light, that is white light, so that all the wavelengths will be there. The colorimetric technique uses radiation in the visible range. Okay, so 400 to 700 is the visible range of the spectrum. For that, tungsten lamp is used. Then you see here the entrance slit. What is the use of entrance slit? So that it should be a point light source, and the parallel rays has to be emerged from that point source. So the entrance slit is there, which is very narrow, and the entrance slit is allowing rays to pass through the condensing lens on the filter which is used here. Filter is nothing but a monochromatic light, colored thin layer of colored glass or dyed gelatin is there. So it's basically a colored glass or dyed gelatin plate of green color, of red color, yellow, blue, whatever the wavelength we are interested in, we can choose that filter, place in front of the condensing lens, or we have knobs on the filter paper, on the colorimeter, so that we can change the filters accordingly or depending on our need. So filters are made, these are the desired monochromatic light of single wavelength which will be passing through the filter. The color of the filter is going to be complementary to the color of the solution. As we have already discussed this point, if the colored solution to be filled in cuvette is green, use red color filter. If the solution is red, use green color filter. So the filter has to be complementary to the color of the solution. Then coming to cuvette, it is a special glass tube made up of quartz having uniform thickness. If the cuvette may be rectangular shape or may be a circular round shape, cylindrical shape, but its thickness will be uniform. Its inner diameter, usually it is 1 centimeter, inner diameter will be uniform. Its outer diameter will be uniform because the thickness is uniform. The cuvette will have uniform refractive index throughout its height. Okay. The bottom of the cuvette may be flat, may be round, but don't worry, because the rays are not passing through the bottom. The rays are passing through the middle 1/3 of the cuvette. So your solution should be filled 2/3 capacity of the cuvette. Photocell. After the cuvette, you see photocell there. The function of the photocell is to convert light energy of the transmitted light will be converted into electrical energy, and the electric current is generated when the light transmitted by the colored solution falls on it. And this galvanometer is a readout device which will show you deflection for the current generated here because of the transmitted light sensed by the photocell. And the galvanometer may show you percent transmittance, which you will have to calculate OD later on depending on that percent transmittance, or this galvanometer can show you optical densities directly if the formula is fed to the galvanometer. There are digital instruments available which can give you directly OD value in the form of digital display. What is the use of blank and standard? Use of blank, that we have already seen, blank and standard are used for comparison. Standard is used for comparison and blank is to eliminate errors. Two types of blanks are used. One is for water blank and other one is for reagent blank. Water blank is used to adjust OD to zero. Means we have to calibrate our colorimeter initially before we start taking optical densities. For the particular wavelength given, if we are using wavelength 530, 620, you have to select the wavelength first and then calibrate your colorimeter with the help of distilled water and set optical density to 0 and percent transmittance to 100. What is reagent blank? Reagents are not distilled waters, even if they do not have any color. Those are different reagents, may have a tinge of color or may not have, but still they will absorb some intensity of light. So if there are reagent in the unknown solution tube, in the unknown solution tube or in standard solution tube, if there are reagents which have not reacted with the analyte of interest, so the unreacted reagent will absorb some intensity of light. Therefore, the blank, reagent blank, is prepared by adding all the reagents except the substance or the analyte to be instrumented. So that whatever the amount of reagent, the quantity of reagent which has not reacted with the analyte in the chemical reaction, which ultimately is going to produce some color, so the reagent which has not taken part into reaction needs to be the error needs to be eliminated. So we take only reagent except the substance to be estimated, and that reagent blank, OD of that reagent blank, we measure and we note it down for calculation, further calculation. Okay, what is the use of standard? That standard we already discussed. It's a solution of known concentration of the analyte of interest in its pure form. Both the concentration and OD of the standard solution are known. So, by cross multiplication, we can find out concentration of the unknown, which is of interest. What are the operational steps? Selection of the proper filter, complementary wavelength should be there. Wash the cuvette with distilled water. Take distilled water in cuvette 2/3 of its capacity, because measurement will be taken in middle 1/3. Okay, remember this. Set colorimeter to 0 percent transmittance with distilled water blank. Take reagent blank, standard and unknown solution, 2/3 of its capacity of the cuvette. Wash the cuvette in between and wipe with the filter paper. Any impurities which is sticking to the cuvette outside also can interfere with the optical density measurement. So wash the cuvette, wipe with filter paper properly. OD of reagent blank, standard and unknown solutions are read and noted for further calculations. Now, calculation is different for each of the quantitative estimation. So, calculation based on the optical density of unknown, blank and standard, and one more entity, control, is there. OD of control will be there, but use of that, these observations will be there differently in further quantitative estimation. So we will look into that part when that particular quantitative estimation we will go for practical, then we can understand it very well. So we are skipping that part, and that will be parameter specific, so we are skipping that part. Estimation applications of colorimetry. What are the applications we have seen? that creatinine, uric acid we have discussed. So basically colorimetry is also known as photometry, used for estimation of various biochemical compounds. All body fluids, the analytes in all the body fluids can be estimated. What are the body fluids? Blood, plasma, serum, CSF, urine, and maybe ascitic fluid, pericardial fluid, etc. So the analytes of interest in these body fluids can be estimated. And which are the analytes in these body fluids? Mostly glucose, urea, creatinine, uric acid, bilirubin, hormones. If the kits are based on photometry, we can do that. Electrolytes also, in the older days, we used to do estimation of electrolyte with colorimetry. Now it is done with ISE. Lipids, total protein, albumin, etc. Enzyme activities for the matter are calculated, are estimated from colorimetry, ALP, SGOT, liver enzymes. Yeah. Minerals like calcium, phosphorus, magnesium can be estimated with the help of colorimetry. Okay. Now coming to spectrophotometry. Spectrophotometry refers to quantification and characterization of colorless compounds. So one of your SLO is differences between colorimetry and spectrophotometry. So the colorimetry detects and measures intensity of color. Here spectrophotometry measures or quantitates or characterizes colorless compounds. It need not have color by irradiating with UV or visible light and measures the absorbance. Most important difference there, colorimetry needs color. Here it doesn't need color, still quantitates. The UV range extends from 100 to 400 nanometer and visible spectrum ranges from 400 to 700 nanometer. So the spectrophotometry may be UV based or visible spectrum based, and we can interchange it. But colorimetry is only based on visible spectrum, that is 400 to 700 nanometers. We'll see the block diagram of spectrophotometry, which is almost similar to colorimetry. Now see, UV light from a deuterium lamp or maybe a hydrogen lamp or mercury or xenon, the discharge again converted into monochromatic beam by quartz or usually a diffraction grating. Now a lens is there like colorimeter, but here there is no filter used. Instead of filter, we are using prism or grating, which creates a spectrum of light, 7 colors, okay, different wavelengths, and we have to choose the wavelength by rotating the prism. So if this is the cuvette, and we want red color of that particular wavelength or the color colored light fall on the cuvette, the instrument will rotate it and the colored light will be, say for example red, will be falling on the cuvette. Okay, so the prism will be rotated so that the light and the cavity is aligned properly. Okay, like this. Here the yellow color is passing through the slit and incident on the cavity. Now UV radiation is absorbed by the functional group. Now here we do not need colored complexes. Functional group, characteristic functional group of protein, like for example peptide bonds, DNA, phosphodiester bonds. Okay, so these bonds or these functional groups have a characteristic absorbance of ultraviolet light, and that property is used for quantitation or identifying the purity of the particular compound with the help of spectrophotometry. The light absorbing functional group are called as chromophores. The absorption leads to excitation of bonding electrons of the compound. The absorbance is detected by a photomultiplier, and absorbance is recorded against the UV light wavelength by a recorder like this. Here the photocell is similar to colorimeter and a digital display of meter. The intensity of the resultant peak is proportional to the concentration of the compound. As usual, a standard solution is known of the known concentration is also irradiated, like we do that for colorimetry, and the absorbance is measured. Absorbance is plotted against the concentration to get a calibration curve. From the curve, the concentration of the test solution could be determined. It is just similar to the colorimeter, but in case of complex spectrophotometer, which will have UV as well as visible spectrum available, like for visible spectrum there is tungsten lamp and for UV there is deuterium lamp and mirror is there. So whichever we want, we will keep that setup on. Again here mirror, slit and a monochromator or prism will be kept here. Slit will be there to align the particular color to the beam splitter. Now this beam will be splitted so that partially the 50% of that will go through reference, 50% of that will go through sample. So there are two cuvettes kept. There are two cuvettes kept, one for reference and one for sample. This reference will tell you the constant monitoring of the reference optical density will enable you to have a QC check on the sample OD check, sample OD estimation. So there may be 10 samples, but reference will be only one. And if the OD of reference will be similar for a particular batch, the sample OD can be accepted and the ODs will be within the acceptable range of deviation. So the QC check will be there on the OD measurement of different samples, maybe 10 or 20 samples will be there. And a calibration curve will be available with data processing. So this is for a spectrophotometer with tungsten lamp as well as deuterium lamp. That is UV visible. Both modes will be available. What are the applications of spectrophotometry? Now we have seen as it can quantitate or characterize depending on the functional groups, characteristic functional group present in compound. There are vast applications of spectrophotometry, like to quantify protein, carbohydrate, NADPH, hemoglobin, chlorophyll, carotenoids, to detect impurities in biological compounds. You can detect purity of DNA sample by 260 to 280 ratio, okay? To investigate geometrical isomers, to detect the functional group of a compound, what functional group the compound is having, depending on the absorbance, okay? Absorbance is maximum with this wavelength, so this particular compound must have this descend this functional group in the structure. So that way you can identify. To confirm the presence of conjugated double bond, aromatic ring, ketoenol tautomeric forms in biological compounds. To identify redox potential, redox pairs also, as it can detect NADPH. To determine specific activity of oxidoreductases and isomerases. To determine dissociation constants of acids and bases and many more. Coming to automation in laboratory. The picture which is shown here is total automation in laboratory. First of all, let us see what is laboratory automation. It is a system of full mechanization of analytical processes. So it is analytical processes, not the pre-analytical processes, remember, with automatic control by feedback algorithms. So there are many feedback algorithms through computer generated responses and all, so as to increase throughput. So with this kind of setup, what will be the throughput? Throughput means number of tests per hour with minimal involvement of manpower. Here you can see, in this particular setup, only 2 or 3 technicians can handle this complete automation in laboratory. So it's a system of full mechanization of analytical processes, which will be governed by automatic control by a central server with feedback algorithms. So as to increase the throughput, obviously without any error, without any hassle, the processes, analytical process will be happening and the throughput of the system will increase, laboratory will increase with minimal involvement of manpower. Manpower will not be required because these are the automatic tracks, sample tracks. These are the automatic sample tracks which, I'll explain you. Here is the place where we are keeping the sample. Even we don't remove the cap of the sample or vacutainer, we keep it here. Depending on the barcode, the barcode readers will read which test has to be performed on which analyzer it needs to be performed. It will be predefined here. It will go to the centrifuge system here. It will be automatically centrifuged depending on the sample. Like for example, if it is serum or if it is plasma separator gel, if it is for hormone, the centrifugation speed will be different. So the temperature will be monitored here, because in the centrifugation it will increase the temperature and will lead to evaporation of the sample. So the temperature as well as the centrifugation speed will be monitored here sample wise and test wise. Okay. And after the centrifugation, the tube will be decapped here at this point, and the tube will be taken to the particular auto analyzer. These are auto analyzers. This may be chemistry, this may be immunoassay. Hormones, tumor marker will be done here, and all photometric LFT, KFT will be done here, along with ISE, that is electrolytes, will be done here. This is another analyzer, probably this is hematology analyzer. Again, this is one counter here. So depending on the sample and the test, it will be taken to the respective instrument and all the tests will be performed. Okay, maybe for a single, in a single tube, this, the sample will be taken in this analyzer and the remaining sample will be taken to another analyzer depending on the investigations requested. And after all the investigations, the samples will be taken to the sample storage area. This is the sample storage area. In this particular sample storage, it will be kept for maybe 1 or 2 days. If it is again required, the sample will be automatically taken from here and taken to the analyzer. If there is no sample and there is no additional test, the tubes will be resealed here and will be taken to the storage area. So this is where all the analytical and post-analytical processes on the sample tube are carried with full mechanization. These instruments are bidirectionally synced with this laboratory information system. All the instruments, the signing author, people will be reviewing the QC, will be monitoring the track of the sample completely through their LIS system. But pre-analytical systems are not automated. What does pre-analytical means? It is collection of the sample, transportation of the sample from the collection site to the laboratory, right? Then placing the barcode on the tube is again mechanical, it's a manual step in most of the laboratories, though it is automatic to some extent by some companies. It is done labeling of the tubes directly on the tube. The barcode labeling is directly automated, directly done on the tube, automated. Okay, but to some extent, though pre-analytical steps are automated, but mostly it is analytical and post-analytical processing of the samples. This, up to this point, the total laboratory automation can be done. Coming to classification of auto-analyzers. So there are semi-automatic analyzers, continuous flow auto-analyzers, discrete analyzers, which may be batch analyzer or random analyzer. What are semi-auto-analyzers? In the semi-auto-analyzer, the test methods or the programs are fed to the instrument. The unknown sample, blank sample, unknown and standard are given to the instrument for, blank and standard are given to instrument for calibration purpose. A multiplication factor is determined for that particular parameter, and then a batch of 20-25 unknown samples can be run, and we can find out concentration of analyte under consideration by multiplying the multiplication factor with the optical density of unknown sample. Okay, so this is to some extent is automated. So what is automated here is the calculation process is automated. Okay, once for the batch we need to do calibration, a factor will be calculated, and as and when required we can again run calibration, or simply we can give samples, put the samples for analysis. Okay, so these are semi auto analyzers. Again, mixing of the reagents for end point method is outside. For semi for kinetic method, for enzyme estimation, and for example creatinine estimation, modified end point methods. So to some extent it is inside the cuvette here, but for end point method the mixing and preparation of the unknown samples, blank and standard, is outside the instrument, outside of this instrument. Okay, continuous flow autoanalyzers, these are here the samples, reagents and diluents are pumped through different tubings. Sample travels sequentially along the same pipeline where they are mixed. After incubation, line leads to colorimeter and output is measured by the recorder. Nowadays, these type of autoanalyzers are not in use due to high cost for maintenance. We are using discrete analyzers, maybe a batch, maybe a random access analyzer nowadays. In a batch analyzer, each sample is analyzed for one batch of particular chemistry test. If that batch analyzer is run for glucose, it will do glucose only. If it is run for creatinine, it will do creatinine of all the samples. Like there are 50 samples with us, if we use batch analyzer, all glucose for those 50 samples can be done at once, then urea, then creatinine, like that. But we can't do, say for example, urea, creatinine, glucose, urea, creatinine for the first sample, then only urea for the second sample, not like that. So batch, this is parameter wise batch is run here. Coming to discrete analyzer, the second variety of discrete analyzer, that is random access autoanalyzer and ion selective analyzer. These are high throughput analyzers, like this is AU680, means 680 tests per hour. Okay, not samples, 680 tests per hour, including ice. High throughput analyzer, many samples can be kept. These are sample racks. These are sample racks and these are reagent racks. You will get a good detailed overview of the random access autoanalyzer when we will take you to the laboratory. In laboratory visit, we will show you analyzers, how they work, where are the sample kept, where are the reagents kept on board, etc. All the details will be shown to you in your laboratory visit. But for now, let us see what are random access autoanalyzer in brief. So many samples can be kept and the testing on the samples can be at random. So you can choose any test for any sample at a given point of time. So you can run your urgent samples first, then elective samples later on, like that. So this is truly a random access autoanalyzer with high throughput. Any particular sample or reagent can be selected, mixed, incubated as per the command to the processing system, in or out of the sequence. So this is called as random access autoanalyzer. Working of autoanalyzer. In autoanalyzer, various steps are similar to those in the traditional manual method of carrying out the analysis by colorimetry. We know, right? Semi-automatic analyzer also and random access autoanalyzer also, those are purely based on photometry. Okay, or to some extent spectrophotometry. The parameter calibration, multi calibrators are there, not the standard one. Like in case of colorimeter or semi automatic analyzer, we get kits where a kit based standard will be there. We'll have to use blank standard for calibration of that parameter, and we can run a batch of 20 for estimation of creatinine in those 20 unknown samples. But in case of random access analyzer, we use multi calibrators. So in a single calibrator, there are many parameters which can be calibrated from that multi calibrator. Same calibrator can be used. The analyzer will take reagents for different parameters and calibrate the profiles, the parameter profiles, and we'll note down, we'll store the multiplication factor for all those parameters. After the parameter calibration is over, the data will be stored, and that data will be used for estimation of different parameters of unknown solutions. Okay. Sample analysis without standard and blank once calibration is done. So calibration needs to be done maybe once in a week or once in 2 weeks. When we see QC is out, then we do calibration. QC, the quality control of laboratory, you will get a knowledge of quality control in laboratory later on in subsequent practical classes, where you will see how the controls are run, what is the use of calibrator. Calibrator I have already told, but still the high level control, low level control, how the QC data is maintained, how the Levy-Jennings charts are plotted, etc. will be known to you in subsequent classes. Reaction occurs in dedicated reaction vessel which acts as a cuvette. Here the reaction vessel itself is a cuvette. So in a plate or in a rack, there are multiple cuvettes kept, and those are the reaction vessels. So the reagents and serum sample from unknown solution is mixed in that with the help of stirrers, and the same will be kept in incubation, on board incubation, for some time, maybe for 5 minutes, 10 minutes, and later on the vessel or the cuvette will be taken to the photocell. Suppose here is the photocell, and the plate will take that cuvette to the photocell. Okay, so that when the light passes, the optical density will be measured by the photocell. After a defined time, the vessel aligns with the photocell to record the absorbance, and the test result is calculated based on the OD and the calibration factor, which was stored after this parameter calibration exercise. Okay. Advantages of auto-analyzers. Obviously, these are computer software based and can be programmed. So self-monitoring features like IQC and calibration data management is the major advantage of auto-analyzers. Another major advantage is high throughput, less chances of analytical errors. Results which are obtained obviously are accurate and reliable because there is no fabrication of the data, like that may happen in semi-automatic analyzers. If we want to write 10, if we are writing 11, that may be a transcription error, but here the random access analyzers are bidirectionally interfaced with LIS. So whatever result is coming out of a test analysis is taken to the laboratory information system, and same will be appearing on the report. So no fabrication of the data, accurate results and are reliable too. Auto analyzers are easy to operate. Once you know the standard operating procedures, these are very easy to operate. They are robust. So the calibration data of the particular parameter will be stable till you change the reagent. Most of the time, till you change the reagent or till you do a major preventive maintenance of the instrument, the calibration data is stable. So you don't have to recalibrate it again and again. Because of the easy operating procedures and all, the entire range of highly complex biochemistry and immunoassay tests can be performed by auto-analyzer. There are integrated systems wherein a single sample can give you biochemistry as well as immunoassay test in one go with the help of this integrated system. Most important is cost per test is considerably reduced. These auto-analyzers are taking samples or the reagent in very minimal quantity. So if you are doing that in case of manual, if you compare manual, semi-automatic analyzers and random access analyzers, so in a reagent which you are using for manual, you can perform 100 to 200 tests in the random access analyzer. Suppose you are taking 3 ml or 4 ml here, for example, in estimation of creatinine, the same quantity reagent, the same kit we can use that for maybe for 50 to 100 tests can be performed. So cost per test is considerably reduced. High throughput enables to finish exhaustive lab sample workload in few hours. So it made us possible to cater so many laboratory services, so complex laboratory services to the patient population in due course of time. Time consuming manual calculations are obviously eliminated. So thank you so much for listening to this session, and I hope all the specific learning objectives have been understood by you, and this topic is important for practical. And obviously one more question, theory question will be asked to you on, a short note question will be asked to you on this demonstration topic, maybe other techniques also like electrophoresis, chromatography, but there will be a compulsory short answer question on one of the techniques. And this topic is important for spot test as well. So you will be shown a colorimeter, or maybe cuvette will be shown to you, and you will be asked to identify the spot given to you, and you will be asked write the applications of the technique involved. So you will be writing applications of colorimetry, not the application of the part shown to you or the spot shown to you. Okay, so write the application of the technique involved. So thank you very much.